I'm Abhay Kadpa, member of the group 15. Our group project is about optimization of heating in closed indoor spaces. It can also be said as reduction of heat load of households using evaporative roof cooling, which is solved by lowering energy consumption in large buildings by reducing the heat load using a combination of sustainable methods. With continuous urbanization, it is important to consider environmental and economic costs of energy consumption. Therefore, our project seeks to use evaporative cooling to decrease cooling costs incurred in hot and dry tropical areas like India. We know that major heat gain in houses is through the day due to the sun in hot dry environments. So it is intuitive to try to reduce the heat from the same. Additional heat gain is due to the occupants, which is unavoidable. Evaporative cooling is a technique where roof surface is covered with water and cooling is achieved through evaporation. Heat due to solar irradiation is absorbed by water, which has high latent heat of evaporation, which results in reducing heat flux into the room. In this method, a layer of water is put on the roof and periodically replenished as it needed. This layer absorbs the heat and evaporates, resulting in net cooling. This is how real-life evaporative cooling system looks like. There is a plain roof along with a water layer. The total system contains the room that needs to be cooled, along with a layer of water on the roof, which is responsible for major cooling and the heat flux reduction. The given schematic diagram denotes the system and the relevant control volume. The system receives heat flux due to solar radiation from the environment, which accounts for almost all the heat gain. The reduction of heat flux occurs due to the water being evaporated by gaining heat through radiation and convection. Heat flux into the room occurs through conduction through the roof and the walls, through brick in the walls and layers of concrete, brick and lime in the roof. Now I will hand over to Krishi.
The major problem which we are planning to solve, or which we have solved in the project, was to estimate and compare the heat flux in two cases of roof, one with a layer of water and other without a layer of water. So first case is the normal condition when there is a three-layered roof, which is directly exposed to the solar radiation and wind convection during the afternoon in hot and dry climate. Second is the roof with a thin layer of water over which the solar radiation is incident, and a little part of the solar radiation or the heat flux goes into the evaporation of water, hence reducing the heat load inside the water, inside the house. Now the consideration in the problems. The most important assumptions and the most important consideration in the problem is that the ambient room temperature inside the room is taken to be 27 degrees Celsius centigrade, which is a normal room temperature which everyone wants in their houses. Second, the temperature outside varies from 35 degrees centigrade to 50 degrees centigrade and is constant and uniform at any point of time. We have considered this temperature range to be the temperature of hot and dry climate, for example, New Delhi. Heat transfer majorly involved in the project was conduction through the roof, convection between the air and the roof and the water in various cases, and conduction through the roof layers. We have also considered solar radiation, which is one of the most important mode of heat transfer in the problem, which is incident for 6 hours in a day and is considered to be a constant using the solar heat constant. Then the control volume is considered to be a cuboidal control. Now we'll see how is the heat flux balanced through the room. In the room, there the heat flux comes through the walls, the roof, the door, and infiltration ventilation, which is the air coming in, going out. Through the wall, roof, and door, the major forms of heat transfer is convection between the air and the layers of the wall, and then conduction within the walls, roofs, doors, etc. Also, one more important form of heat transfer is the solar radiation incident on the roof. These are the various diagrams of various parts of the room. This is the wall, this is the roof, and this is the floor. The roof is made up of three layers, which is the brick, concrete, and lime, and there is a thin layer of water, which is that this shows the evaporative cooling. Now let us consider control volumes and integral balance of our two cases. Case one, when there is no layer of water on the roof. You can see that this is the roof, and the whole roof is taken as control volume, which has three layers of lime, concrete, and brick. The temperatures outside is known as T infinity. The temperature of the surface is known as the TS, and temperature inside is known as the TN. There is radiative heat flux, which is the solar heat flux, which is incident on the upper layer of the roof. There is reflective heat flux. There is convection between the moving wind, which is considered to have a velocity of 10.32 km per hour, which is an average velocity in hot and dry climate, and the upper layer of the roof. And then there is conduction within the layer of the roof, and there is convection between the layer of the roof and the inner air or the room air. The integral balance could be written in the following sense, that the Q radiation plus Q convection minus Q reflection is the Q conductive, and Q conductive is equals to Q in. Therefore, eliminative Q conductive, we get the integral balance for the complete control volume. That is Q radiative plus Q convective minus Q reflective equals to Q in. Next, let us analyze the second case when there is a layer of water over the roof. You can check in this case that we have solved the problem in two steps. First step, we have considered the control volume to be only the water layer. And second step, we have considered the control volume to be the whole layer of roof, leaving the water layer. So in the first case, when there is radiative heat flux, which is incident on the water, there is some amount of reflection taking place. And this radiative heat flux leads to evaporation of water, which leads to the Q evaporative, which goes in the evaporation of water. Then there is convection between the moving wind and the upper layer of water. And then there is convection between the lower layer of water and the upper layer of the roof, which is known as the Q net. Hence, we can write the integral balance equation for the first control volume as Q net equals to Q radiative plus Q convective minus Q reflective minus Q evaporative. Then we consider the second control volume, which is the control volume of the three layers of roof. In three layers of roof, there is Q net, which is coming from water, and that is equals to Q conduction within the roof, and then that is equals to the Q in, which goes from the lower layer of roof to the inner room through convection between the air and the lower layer of roof. Now I would hand over to Lakshman.
Hello everyone, I'm Lakshman. So with our modes of heat transfer defined by Krishi before, we get the following temperature profiles, where convection takes place on the outside, conduction through the roof layers, and again convection takes place inside. With the addition of a water layer, the only change that appears is that of an extra convective water transfer over here. Now let's have a look at the heat transfer modes and let's have a look at a little bit of the equations. So the net heat transfer is defined by Krishi before. It is also equal to the difference in temperature across the roof divided by the net resistance. The convective heat transfer is the convective heat transfer coefficient and is the temperature difference. And the radiative heat transfer is equal to the incident radiation minus the radiation leaving the roof. The convective heat transfer contains the free and forced convection both. Let's take an example. Let's suppose the outside temperature is 310 Kelvin. On solving all these equations, we attain the roof surface temperature as 314 Kelvin. Now let's put that back into the equation and let's see what values we get. We get the radiation heat transfer as 1300 approximately watt per meter square. So per area, we get the convective heat transfer as minus 1300. That means it's leaving the roof watt per meter square again per area. The convective heat transfer coefficient comes out to be about 330 watt per meter square Kelvin. And the total heat transfer comes out to be about 15 watt per meter square. Now let's have a look at the case with water layer present. In this case, the only major difference that appears over here is the appearance of an evaporative heat transfer term. This depends on the convective heat transfer coefficient and some constant experimental. Now let's take another example. Let's say the outside temperature is 310, same as before, and let's say on solving all these equations, we get the water surface temperature is 306. Which is much lower than the 314 that we had obtained for the roof surface. Again, plugging in, we get these values. The important thing is the value of net heat transfer, which is 6, which has decreased from 15 and almost become half of it. Now, solving these equations required the use of Python along with SymPy. SymPy helped in creating equations, symbolic equations, where we could have a variable, which was, for example, the temperature of the surface or the water surface temperature. So, and then we created the equation and then solved the equation. And after solving, we plotted our results, and due to our approximations, the final output was almost linear. So now Akshita would continue with our conclusion and impact.
So to conclude this presentation, we considered two cases, one where there is a water layer on the roof and one where there is no water layer, which is the standard case. This was to ensure that we are able to present some sort of finding about the reduction of the incoming heat flux in line with our original goal of reducing energy and electrical costs, right? So we see that there is a drastic reduction observed when evaporative cooling is used and a water layer is placed on the roof. There is a reduction of up to 50% to 75%. But even keeping in mind that we have used several simplifying assumptions that allow us to solve these specific models, we say that even if these assumptions are not used, there will be some sizable reduction that would be seen when we use evaporative cooling, which leads us to believe that this method is indeed viable to achieve a reduction in heat flux and a consequent reduction in the cooling load of the house. We know that the energy required to evaporate 1 liter of water is around 0.67 kilowatt hour or 2.4 megajoule. And the energy spent in 1 hour of AC cooling is around 3.571 kilowatt hour or 12.8 megajoule. So we know that evaporation of, say, 5.5 liters of water from the roof would lead to reduction in heat flux equivalent to reduction in energy cost of up to 1 hour of air conditioning. Even keeping that in mind, that the amount of water evaporating throughout the day would vary, we can say that we are able to achieve some reduction in the energy requirement and economic costs of air conditioning. And in addition to that, the advantages of using evaporative cooling are the facts that it doesn't have a high cost of setup, and it has negligible maintenance and operational costs. All you need to do is have a flat roof and enough water to cover it. Therefore, we say that evaporative cooling is a fairly viable method and is effective to a high degree, to a significant degree, when we try to reduce the energy and economic requirements of cooling in hot and dry areas within India or elsewhere. With that, we would like to conclude our presentation. Thank you very much.